Hey everyone, welcome back to Magic TV on the Magic Cruise. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Gavin Verhey for another top 8 list. It's Gavin's top 8 most miserable decks to play against.
Yeah!
Fun for everyone, right?
Oh yeah, some of these are great.
I mean, when I think Gavin Verhey, I usually think pain and suffering, so this makes sense, really. Number 8 on our list, we've got here the old Counterbalance Top.
Ah yes, legacy staple, extended deck. Everything is going great, you're playing against a control deck, and then they have this top in play, they're manipulating things, and that's kind of annoying, but then the counterbalance comes down, and it's all downhill from there. And the problem is you have to keep playing, because it's like, well, maybe he doesn't have a 3 on top of his library, maybe he drew it at some point. Nope, all your spells are systematically countered, and then they kill you with like a Vendilion Click or something. And how fun is that, Tristan?
Only the 8th most fun thing. Number 7 on our list is good old Dredge.
Yeah, Dredge. So the awesome thing about Dredge is you don't get to actually play Magic. You're playing Magic and they're playing like some weird other game that involves putting cards in their graveyard and not casting any spells. In fact, I've seen people win with Dredge with only game actions. So that's pretty impressive. They never cast a spell, they just like return their Icarids, attack, get some zombie tokens. It's not Magic.
It's a good trivia question for your kid, for your friends, or your friends. You go to the game store, you're like, all right, well, how can you win a game of Magic by never casting a spell?
It created up, apparently.
You did answer the question. That was, man, now you know the, it's like Jeopardy, right? What is Dredge?
Annoying.
Yeah, it's real fun. It's so things that are non-interactive, you're probably going to see a lot of on this list, because fun games of Magic are interactive.
Right, and also like thing about Dredge too is that makes it extra annoying is you always have to sideboard like 8 pieces of graveyard hate, or you just lose to it. But then you have 8 cards in your sideboard, and
long gone are the days it's like, well, I boarded in my 2 Tormod's Crypts. I thought I was going to win this match.
Right. Now everyone knows the jig is up.
Number 7, we have, well, we did number 7. Number 6, we have Storm.
Storm. So, once again, they do some innocent things in the first couple turns. Might be tutoring a little bit or, you know, drawing some cards with Center Visions. And then before you know it, you're sitting there for 20 minutes while they combo you off. It's not always a fun experience. I did this today. I'm guilty. I played Storm in Modern. And, you know, my opponent just sat there while I killed them. And, you know, they one of them wanted to go to the bathroom and they couldn't because I was just sitting there trying to kill them. So.
Longest turn 3s in Magic history usually happen when playing with a Storm deck. And nothing has really changed. You can take out who the key players are, but as long as the mechanic is there, it's still doing the same thing. It could be Brain Freeze, could be Tendrils, could be Grape Shot, could be Empty the Warrens. All you know is you're not really having fun.
Yeah, it's pretty miserable. And the worst part is, once again, you have to play it all out because maybe they'll fizzle. Maybe they'll like kill themselves with Ad Nauseam or something. And that's just gross.
Next up on our list is good old Fashioned Drago.
Oh, yeah. So good old Bueller Blue, Lauer Blue. Just imagine, you're sitting there. You have a bunch of counter spells in your hand. And your opponent just keeps casting spells. You keep countering them. And then you kill them with a Rainbow Efreet. That's just embarrassing, man. You died to Rainbow Efreet.
You might have had up to 3 Socking Stones as well.
Sure. We got to give credit where the credit is due. But you might have disked those away at some point if they ever managed to resolve
your
anything.
Your opponent might have also slipped into a coma during this match. That is also something that is very likely. The games often include, you know, a little Whispers of the Muse with buyback, a little Forbid with buyback. A little sleepiness.
Good old fun Fashion Magic. Don't you guys love 1997?
It's like you got that Force Spike in that deck for early plays, and you can pitch it to Forbid later in the game. Keep the train a-chuggin'.
Oh, yeah. Then Whispers again. It's great.
Number 4 on our list, we've got the Fairies, a good friend of Drago.
Oh, yeah, Fairies. I remember playing this deck. It was so much fun. You got to Mistbind click them out of their... out of their mana, you got to Cryptic Command down all their attackers, you got to make them discard cards, you got to counter spells. How could it get any better?
You could also have an enchantment you cast on turn 2 that just made people rage.
Yeah,
that
was wonderful. In addition to all this, how about I just create tokens every turn and chump block you or kill you or anything? The fact that everything in Fairies is just attached to a card advantage engine is just absurd. You're like, spell stutter sprite, counter your spell, click away your best card, Mistbind click you, soar your guy. Can we do that again, Tristan, together this time?
I don't know if we can synchronize it. I don't want to.
We can make it the new end credits.
Oh, it will be.
Number 3 on our list. I'm a little actually surprised by this, because maybe I don't quite follow it. What is a red-blue core?
Red-blue vor.
That is probably why it's miswritten.
So you guys remember red-blue Magnivore. So this was a very popular standard deck. And part of the reason why LD is just never good anymore, because it was miserable. You sat down, it'd be like boomerang your turn two land. I have nowhere your next land. Stone rain your land. Kill your land. Compulsive research. Kill your land. Kill your land. Wildfire. You have no lands. I have two lands. Eventually, I'll drop to four lands, play Magnivore, and I'll kill you. And you once again, you have to play Magic the whole time. And once again, you're just miserable because you can't cast your spells. I mean, nothing is more miserable than being like, well, I have to discard some cards and because I don't have any lands to cast them. But apparently, actually, there are a couple things that are more miserable on this list. But this is certainly high up there.
This one hurts. It's a dagger because I love LD. And I think it's a little bit of a cheat when you're playing Boomerang and Eye to Nowhere and Wildfire off some Tron lands and red-blue signets. So I'll give it to you on that one. But usually, I'm a man that enjoys a good stone rain.
I mean, one thing that's like a precise, strategic, tactical stone rain is cool. Like, you blow up their one land. When you just have, like, 26 stone rains, though, that's over the top, man.
26 stone rains, 4 Magnivores, maybe 4 Terravores. Sounds like a deck.
Almost like an annoying deck. Perhaps one that would be on this list, if it existed.
Number two, we've got Turbo Fog.
Ah, yes. Nothing is better than the grand old days of Turbo Fog, where you attack every turn, they tap one mana to cast Fog, which is embarrassing, by the way. You're losing to, like, Holy Days and Fogs, and they're drawing cards off Howling Mines or Otherworldly Atlas or whatever. And then eventually they might kill you by, like, decking you, perhaps reshuffling their library a couple times so they have enough cards. You just want to take a nap the whole time.
Oh, yeah.
And every turn, you have this moment of excitement, this euphoric excitement when you attack, and they think, you're like, maybe they don't have the fog this time, they cast a card drawing spell, maybe they don't have it, and then they just fog, and you fall back down into your chair, slumping.
And it's so disheartening when they get to the multiple Howling Mines where it's like, you know, ah, you're using a fog every turn. I'm going to get through this wall of fog. And it's like, draw four. I go. Angel Song, Holy Day, Fog, Safe Passage.
Yes. But bonus points if you're playing the version that used Time Warp to loop infinite turns and then kill them slowly with the Jace. That was really fun.
Somebody tells you liked this deck.
I mean, I've definitely played it a lot. You thank Bill Stark for that one.
Yeah. All right. Number one on our list, what could be the most annoying, just frustrating, just miserable deck to play against?
I'll give you three words. Pay a blue.
Good old Stasis.
Ah, yes, Stasis.
Why are you a Magic card?
Just between the artwork, the ability, everything together, you look at this and it does not a card you want to play with. You put it down and you know you're in for the long haul. Your Winter Orb's down on lands, maybe your Stasis down on lands. They're paying a blue every turn. And then they just do, you know, boomeranging at the end of your turn, untap all their lands, play the Stasis again. It is a long and miserable death. And once again, you just have to sit there as the blue mage grinds you down. It's like the best of two worst worlds. It's like Crisis on Infinite Terrible Worlds, because you have both the elements of, like, draw go, some counter spells, you've got the long grindy game of Turbo Fog, you've got the fact you have to sit there and wait forever. Stasis, not fun.
And yet, on another top 8 list here at Magic 2. It's not its first appearance, but it's a good one, and it's a good lesson to be learned. I'll tell you what's not fun. It's not being able to untap. Because we all take untapping for granted these days.
It's true. I remember someone played Winter Orb against me in Cube the other day, and I was like, this isn't Magic. Like, what am I doing here? So, yeah, don't put Stasis in your cube, really. Please don't.
And there you have it. For Gavin Verhey, I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Magic TV on the Magic Cruise. And thanks for watching.